What makes a Wendy's hamburger different? Fresh beef. And while Wendy's may have to go the extra mile to never use frozen beef, unlike some other guys, the result is so worth it. Wendy's, the official hamburger of the NCAA.
BBVA Compass Stadium in Houston, Texas. Today, U.S. coach Jill Ellis continuing to assess her squad today for the second time in 4 days against number 23 in the world, Russia. Young fans out in force here today. United States taking on Russia next. Welcome to ESPN's coverage of the U.S. Women's National Team. Today, we come to you live from BBVA Compass Stadium in Houston, Texas. The U.S. Women's National Team playing host to number 23, Russia. And welcome in, everybody. I'm Glenn Davis. Alongside me, she's former U.S. Women's National Team player, gold medalist, World Cup winner, Julie Foudy. Excited about this one here today. And, of course, the U.S. getting a 4-0 victory 4 days ago against Russia in Frisco. What was the takeaway from that game?
Well, I think they needed a win. They could have been 8-0, really, but they needed a win, especially after what we saw in March at the She Believes Cup. They needed to end on a positive note.
All right, speaking of the She Believes Cup, let's take a look back at that. It started out in positive fashion for the United States. They won a win over Germany. Lynn Williams getting the goal in that one that would provide the difference. So they were off and running, experimenting with a new three-back system against England. The U.S. would get shocked 1-0. Not only that, they would get shut out. And then, to cap it off, Carly Lloyd and company against France, well, they took a beatdown. 3-0 was the final in that one, and it sent shockwaves throughout the U.S. soccer community. How much was this about a system?
Well, a lot of people criticized that back three, but I actually don't think it was just about the back three. You can't blame only the center back and Ali Long or the other two defenders, but I think it was all around. Let's take a look at that, those three goals, and we'll start with the first one, of course. And really, Ali Long took a lot of the heat in this at the center back position. She bites left, which I don't actually think is that bad a move. It's just a great ball in. But look at Nayer, little late off her line, and especially in a three back. We're going to look at this on the second goal. She has a PK given there. They score it, but this is the second goal. Look at this, is a 50 to 60 yard ball. Long gets beat for pace, but really Nayer in a three back, as the goalkeeper should be sitting right behind them, picking that up easily at the top of her box. Instead, rooted to the line there, and France in for the second. And then I'll blame the midfield a little bit, because you got five in the midfield. When you have five in the midfield, you have to get more pressure on the ball. Look at, you have three people around them, no one tackling, coming in a little bit late. And then Ali Long here gets caught. Now, Ali Long has not played in the center back position. Let's remind people that much. And especially in the three back, she gets caught where she's in a position where her body can't see behind her. She's caught ball watching. And of course, a team like France is going to do well against those.
And that, the Continental Tire Analyst Corner, brought to you by Julie. Teams are taking the field here in Houston. Lineups kickoff coming up next on ESPN.
This is what precision looks like, helping you see what's hard to see. Thanks to Terrain Denali's Side Blind Zone Alert that uses radar to watch your blind spots. So it's true, Mom does have eyes in the back of her head. The GMC Terrain with rear vision camera, child safety locks, Stabilitrack, theft deterrent system, and more. Or get this low mileage lease on this Terrain SLE1 for around $199 per month. Plus, current non-GM lessees can get $1,500 additional lease cash.
Premiering tonight on Reels, Katie Holmes.
I want him to grow up to be a good boy. I have no better dream for him.
Matthew Perry.
I'm a better man because of her.
And introducing Brett Donahue as JFK Jr.
I want you to do something that would make your father proud.
My father is dead. Over a quarter century ago, my father stood before you.
The Kennedys After Camelot, world premiere tonight at 9 on Reels.
Welcome back to BBVA Compass Stadium here in Houston, Texas, as the United States getting set to take on Russia. 81 degrees here, and another day of assessment for both of these coaches. Let's start with Russia's Elena Formina, who is the first Russian female to take this squad. Former player and captain of Russia, has appeared over 100 times as a player, playing in two World Cups. Here is their starting lineup in a 4-5-1.
And they switched formations from that 4-4-2 to 4-5-1, and four changes to the lineup. You'll see a lot of numbers behind ball. Russia hoping to keep USA off the board early.
closing in on 3 years with the U.S. national team. Jill Ellis, 50 years of age, born in Portsmouth, England. Again today, a big day of assessment for her here in 2017. They are 2-0-2. Starting lineup here today, a lot of familiar faces.
And staying with that four back, they switched out of the three back. One change to the lineup, Ashlyn Harris in at goal, Carly Lloyd and Crystal Dunn getting the start again up top. But take a look at Rose Lavelle, the 21-year-old, in only her third cap on Thursday night against Russia. This is what she has the potential to do from that right midfield spot. She also plays centrally. So good on the ball, so confident on the ball. Mind you, this is only her third cap, as I just said. And what she does so well is she runs at that back line on the dribble. You can see her going at defenders, putting it on her favorite left foot. She almost finishes one off here on Thursday night. But that is a player to watch today and in the future.
And in the words of Jill Ellis, putting a big investment in her right now. Russia in red, the United States in white. Your referee is Karen Apt. It's game on here in Houston, Texas. 81 degrees here. The second meeting again in 4 days for these two teams. In differing places, Russia preparing for the upcoming European Championships in the Netherlands, the United States, and Jill Ellis continuing to assess her players under game conditions here. Megan Klingenberg getting back into the lineup here is under a bit of pressure here. Casey Short will knock this into midfield now. Crystal Dunn had 2 goals on Thursday in Frisco, Texas. Karpova trying to get something going here for the Russians. We had a big trouble getting out of their own half on Thursday night. Carly Lloyd here at the halfway line trying to break her way through. They'll knock it all the way back to the goalkeeper, Ulia Grichenko, who will get the start here today. Her 13th cap. Mallory Pugh already creating some problems here. Pugh has come central. It's a nice ball towards Carly Lloyd. With her left arm, fends a defender off. Grichenko gets there first. Lloyd goes down, Grichenko down, and it'll be a throw-in. Ulia Grichenko remains down.
And this is where the U.S. was so dangerous on Thursday night as well. It's those little slipped-in balls. Russia has so many problems with that back line, and you can see Carly Lloyd just trying to sneak one in there. Doesn't quite have the pace to finish that off like a Crystal Dunn would beside her. But that's going to be a system of play you see a lot today for the United States, especially with Crystal Dunn.
Boy, the right foot of Carly Lloyd just wrapping itself around the head of Grichenko here. And that's why she's down. Yeva started in goal in the first game. 27-year-old Julia Grichenko up. Carly Lloyd in this higher position. Do you like her up there with Crystal Dunn, Julie?
I do. I like that you've got the pace of Crystal Dunn to open up that back line. And you've got Carly Lloyd able to hold it, able to play that ball in.
That's a possession there from Klingenberg now. It was a real struggle for Russia. Really to create things and get any extended possession in Frisco. So once again, this seems to be an exercise for the United States, Julie, in breaking down deep defending teams.
And you can see already they've got their outside backs in Klingenberg and Kelly O'Hara playing all the way pushed up.
Klingenberg trying to recover here, trying to get her feet under her after the back injury. Here is Rose Lavelle, who we featured in the open, has been just so much fun to watch, has brought a real freshness to the national team along with Mallory Pugh.
And similar to Mallory Pugh, a young kid who comes in and immediately fits in, which, as we know, we've seen over the decades, is not easy to do.
Lloyd, big switch of play from Carly Lloyd, now playing at Manchester City. And in the attack, Kelly O'Hara now. This is where she likes to be in that attacking third. Crystal Dunn in the box now, had two on Thursday, tackled away. Klingenberg will clip it to the back post. Grichenko comes, punches away. The offside flag was up anyway. It'll be a free kick for Russia. Number 23 in the world They qualified for the Euros in 2017. They'll play in the Netherlands in a very difficult group, which includes Sweden, Italy, Germany.
And they know Germany quite well because that was the qualifying group they were in as well. Those were their only two losses in qualifying. They had two draws, two losses. The two losses came to Germany. But that is a tough group for Russia.
Sauerbrunn now. Casey Short now, the Chicago Red Star. She's going to be right back here this coming weekend to take on the Houston Dash as the NWSL opens. She might as well stay over. Short has brought that tremendous athleticism to the back. This despite three ACL injuries, which is...
Her story is tremendous.
Unbelievable.
And at critical points in her career where she was trying to play professionally, she tears it in college, she gets on the under-23s, tears it again.
Offside flag up again, and that was a bit of a problem on Thursday night as the U.S. got caught getting in a bit early with some timing problems. Good look at Casey Short and two goals in 20 games in the NWSL, but a player that really has sort of energized the national team, played in Norway also, and in college for Florida State University under Mark Krikorian.
Carly thought she was bringing it up. She's just putting it to where the spot was for the offside.
Russian players all play in a local domestic league. They have six teams at the top division. They are full-time pros. Sport is still having problems really connecting with youth. It's a growing program. They're investing more in it, and they're hoping to do well in the European Championships. Becky Sauerbrunn now. Lavelle coming back deep to pick up the ball. This little entry ball. Lloyd tries to push it towards Dunn. Dunn's going to explode, and she's likely going to get there first. Crystal Dunn now. Diastanova trying to close her down. Lavelle. Thursday night, we saw the tricks and flicks. Allie Long. Ewis, Lavelle. Klingenberg's ball cut out. And Casey Short is just going to glide there and push it back to her goalkeeper, Ashlyn Harris.
And that's exactly why Jill Ellis, speaking to her yesterday, moved Casey from that wide position into that center back position because of that pace. It's almost a stopgap measure. Even if you get beat on one side, you got Casey Short on the other.
In comes the United States for a chance to make it one, kicked away by Grichenko. Big opportunity for Klingenberg. Here's Lavelle now, lays it on. First touch from Mallory Pugh, and over the end line it goes. It'll be a U.S. corner as they penetrate via the pass.
And here's Lavelle just slipping a nice ball in to Pugh, and this is what these two can do. And Lavelle has that freedom to come inside, which we showed in the open there. She's going to pinch in, especially because she has that left foot that's favored. So on the right side, she's going to often drift in and try and thread it right there.
Off the corner, Lavelle with her left foot. It's helped on there by Grichenko. It'll be another corner for the U.S. Julie, Pugh and Lavelle have that ability to both come inside, which makes them very flexible for Jill.
And these are two of the youngest players on the team and so dynamic. We said it earlier on. Both came in, and what has impressed me the most is as you watch young kids come in, there's that nerve factor and that lack of confidence. And these two just came in flying and looking great and confident going at players.
Lavelle got real minutes in the She Believes Cup. And she'll take the corner again. To the six, Grichenko has been coming off her line and punching things out. Klingenberg. So Harris showing up on the far side of the field. Cleared by Russia. Casey Short's going to be first there. Megan Klingenberg now. That back injury has kept her out for a while, trying to work her way back into the U.S. picture here. After pretty much owning that left back position for quite some time. Casey Short now. Throws a nice ball to Carly Lloyd. Lloyd trying to get turned, facing the Russian defense. Offside flag is up. As Allie Long getting into a higher position here in the box.
And this is the risk reward that, Russia plays. You can see Allie Long clearly in an offside position there. But they play a very aggressive high line.
Long had two headers and two goals on Thursday night in the 4-0 win. Plays for the Portland Thorns. Had an eventful night. Also missed from the penalty spot. But in the She Believes Cup, she played in the middle of a back three. And you and I know from doing some games prior that that was kind of a new venture for her.
Yeah, she'd just recently been switched into that center back position so she could have that playmaking ability from the back line. But that's a lot to ask of a player trying to learn that center back position and to play against a team like France.
It'll be a free kick, and Russia thought they had an opportunity there. Sochneva, who's appearing today for the 82nd time, thought she had stripped Allie Long.
And I think a lot of people were critical of that three back, but I don't necessarily think it's the system. I think that it's the way you play it. We showed it in the beginning of the show, Glenn, is you got to have a super aggressive goalkeeper behind you, cleaning things up almost as a second keeper. I thought Nayer was a little deep on a lot of plays, and especially knowing that Long may struggle a little bit with pace in that three back.
Got that long switch of play there from Lavelle, again showing she's got a long range of passing as well. Just has an amazing skill set. As does Mallory Pugh, who's going to turn 19 at the end of this month. And remarkably, has had an amazing 2016. Ashlyn Harris getting the nod today, won three national championships at North Carolina. 31-year-old. Just overhit off the left foot of Carly Lloyd, who came back into midfield to playmake there, trying to pick out Mallory Pugh.
And that's going to be on all day, because again, you see Russia playing aggressively with a high line and that switch. Just a little too much on that ball, but that switch is on because they're pressing and condensing.
Klingenberg back to Casey Short. I mentioned that Chicago will be here next Saturday. It's pretty interesting. It's an NWSL MLS doubleheader. So the Houston Dash will take on Chicago at 1 o'clock. And then in the evening, the Houston Dynamo of Major League Soccer will take on Minnesota.
And a lot of tailgating in between.
A lot of tailgating in between and other things. And of course, lots of excitement around the NWSL finally getting it kicked off this coming weekend. Here's Lloyd, pocket of space here with the outside of her foot. O'Hara is in. She is flying into the box for the U.S., drives it. Rachenko somehow saves it. And it'll be another corner for the United States. It's a bit of a shooting gallery here right now.
The way the U.S. is shaping up right now, Kelly O'Hara there is playing like a right midfield. It's almost like a 3-5-2, and Rachenko does so well not to cheat that cross, because you see O'Hara look up like she's going to bring it across. What a nice first touch that is, too. She takes a look and decides, I'm going to try and get one on frame. Rachenko holding her line, holding her angle.
She's been knocked in the head. She's punched a ton of balls out here so far. Has come up with a couple of sparkling saves. So Rachenko has been very busy here and showing very well inside 14 minutes.
And Kelly O'Hara, when she plays at that right back position, the thing she thinks about first is getting forward. And so you see the way the U.S. is lining up. Rose Lavelle, who's her right midfielder in front of her, is cutting inside, having that freedom to roam, and opening up that space for O'Hara to bomb down that sideline there. She's going to do a lot of that today, as she did on Thursday night as well. And really a familiar position for her, because Kelly O'Hara played forward in college quite well, very well.
That's Akina's birthday today. Short wanted a two-on-one out here. Saw it coming. Lavelle, that ball from Klingenberg waited a little short. This hit, Luchenko goes down, makes a save. Lloyd over the, make that Crystal Dunn over the top in her 50th appearance for the U.S. today. Offside flag was up.
Nice looking at Dunn is in the right spot. You're gonna want that one back. Hard to adjust your body quickly to get over that one. But the U.S. knocking at the door.
You all remember Crystal Dunn winning the under 20 World Cup back in 2012. Did not make the 2015 team. Had an outstanding season in the NWSL. Won the Golden Boot and fought her way back into the first team here. Big switch of play and a good one. If they can get there, they can't. But with some real power by Karpova. Russia tries to hold the U.S. in their half here on this sequence. Short, Ashlyn Harris. Amazing career of Becky Sauerbrunn. Direct here over the top and been a little bit of duress here, going to concede the throw. Made that a little bit more difficult than they had to. U.S. 10-0-1 against Russia. They've never met in an official competition. Klingenberg. O'Hara creeping forward here on the right side. Long, Becky Sauerbrunn now caught in possession, but it'll be a throw in for the United States. Pugh has come back in between the two lines. What a goal from Mallory Pugh. U.S. are off and running here. Lloyd hitting the penalty area, goes over her head. It's O'Hara now. She can't control it, and a throw in to Russia, but it happened so quickly off the feet of Mallory Pugh.
Having success, the U.S. is when they get in that little seam between Russia's back line and midfield, turn and then slip that ball in because of that high back line for Russia. Especially a lot of success for those outside backs, getting Klingenberg and O'Hara on the other side.
Allie Long now. Russia will win it back. Danilova. This is a long ball forward here. Karpova. She's pretty much playing in a lone striker role. She's got her work cut out for her with the pace of Casey Short here today. After we're done here at BBVA Compass Stadium, we're going to take you down to an Eastern Conference clash between Kyle Larin, Orlando City, Bradley Wright Phillips, and the New York Red Bulls. MLS Soccer Sunday presented by Audi, also streaming live on the ESPN app. And watch ESPN. The New York Red Bulls reeling after getting dismantled last weekend 4-1 by the Houston Dynamo. And Orlando City sitting at 2-0 at home. That's a good one down there in that beautiful new stadium in Orlando. Catch up with Adrian Healy and Taylor Twellman right after this one. Pugh trying to get there. Awkward clear, and it'll be another corner for the United States as Bella Mitseva raked out with the outside of her right foot, and the U.S. is going to get another corner here. 19th minute. Fourth corner of the game. Again, it's another short one. Top of the box is O'Hara now. Remember, she's the right back. Her shot is blocked. Pugh is switched over to the right side of the field. Short wins that. Casey Short driving forward here. Goes in full-blooded into the tackle. Dunn trying to get there. And to the penalty spot we go. The United States will have a chance to get on the scoreboard here first. Dunn is brought down in the box.
And all of that play started by the hustle of Casey Short. She just fights through to get that ball in there. Dunn doing well to go down with a little contact. Let's see how much contact here. Not much, does well. I think it's a good call still. But that is a Casey Short started play with her hustle.
Kovalienko bringing her down to the penalty spot is Carly Lloyd against Grichenko. Grichenko gets a hand on it. Lloyd will score. It's her 97th career goal for the United States here, and they take a 1-0 lead here against Russia.
Not the prettiest setup we've ever seen by the United States, but Short fighting in and a little bit clumsy. Coming in, Dunn feels that pressure and takes it well. And Lloyd with a nice finish. Grichenko almost getting a hand on that one.
So it's five consecutive goals now going back to Thursday in Frisco, Texas for the U.S. Lavelle spins out of there beautifully. Again showing off her talents. Here's Crystal Dunn. Dunn eliminates one. Standing on it here allows O'Hara to get into the attack. Back to Crystal Dunn towards the end line. Dunn now playing in England for the Chelsea Ladies. O'Hara fighting back. Becky Sauerbrunn now out of St. Louis. Mewis to Klingenberg. Widening the game out here is Mallory Pugh. Yeah, this is overhead. Grichenko's going to get there. Jill Ellis talked to us a lot about the wide game, its importance, and how that she wants to really see this team improve in that area.
Yeah, she said, you know, I used to be more concerned about that central area losing Holiday and Box, of course. And she said, now what I'm really focused on is that wide area and building that out. And you can see she's got some younger players right now playing in that space, that outside back position. She's rotated through a lot of players, Short typically out wide. Klingenberg has been out injured for almost a year. She told me yesterday, Klingenberg, it was last May her back started hurting.
Beautiful switch of play. This is what Sam Mewis can do. And that was a beautifully measured pass. Here's Dunn. She's one-on-one. She's going to get to the end line. She's lost a defender to the back post. Trickles through everybody. Pugh was getting in there, hitting the six. Mewis wins it back. It's Klingenberg now. And Jill Ellis has really been investing in Sam Mewis. A lot of minutes in the She Believes Cup. And here she is on the ball now. O'Hara. Dunn, no work of give and go. O'Hara's going to clip it and over everybody. The cross does not live up to it. It'll be a throw in Russia.
We also talked to Jill about that three back and whether she faulted the three back or the positioning. And she said, I'm not adverse to playing that three back position. And I think that was a great test for us. And I totally agree with that, right? You have to take those stumbles to learn. You clearly don't want to lose 3-0 and twice at home in the She Believes Cup, but I think if you're going to play that three back position, it may be asking too much out of Allie Long in that center back position, and you got to play it differently then. You got to get your goalkeeper higher, you got to get your midfield more active, getting behind the ball with the five in the midfield. So, all things you learn by playing good teams in those positions, though.
And she made it very clear. She has not given up on the three back system for the United States because she wants to get an additional player into central midfield. Here's Carly Lloyd. Splits two. Still trying to fight her way through. Broken up.
And you have to play it against good teams because you play it against a Russia, which essentially they are right now, and you just don't get exposed.
We're going to look back and say that was an incredible tournament for learning about yourself. And she's admitted that already and said, look, this is the type of games we needed. Karpova is going to chase there. Sauerbrunn protecting Ashlyn Harris, the 31-year-old. Is in the 2015 World Cup squad. One of the goalkeepers done again. She's off and flying.
There was a perfect example. Ashlyn Harris at her 30-yard line easily picking up that through ball, right? Playing a little higher. Makes it super simple. Sauerbrunn doesn't even have to track. So it's those little things positionally they're going to learn.
Also spent some time playing in Germany with Duisburg. Of course, Carly Lloyd at Manchester City, who rejoined the NWSL in the Houston Dash in June, but had her on a local ESPN radio show that I have, and she was talking about, you know, how she stays at the Manchester City facilities throughout the day, takes a book after training, reads a while, works on the computer, then goes back out and trains again, lives in an apartment complex where Pep Guardiola, the manager of Manchester City in the Premier League, lives, and has met him on the elevator, and he ends up showing up at one of her games. So she is just totally inundated in,
like, the perfect life,
that English soccer culture. Not to mention she'll be playing in the Champions League against Alex Morgan and Lyon
in a couple weeks' time, the semifinals there. How about that?
You see that as a trend in the future? Do you see more U.S. players heading overseas for to get themselves in those cultural environments? Carly says it's a different game there. It's a lot more technical than the transitional NWSL.
I think the money is there clearly for the player to go, but after this year, I think you're going to see less of it because we get closer to World Cup cycle. And they're going to want to stay closer to home. So this is why you're seeing it, I think, in 2017, because they can go now. It's considered a, you know, quote, off year.
Yeah, the focus for the U.S. and Jill Ellis is the 2019 Women's World Cup. Hence, you can try different things, groom different players, create more competition, which she's doing. Well, it's a good build up here from Russia, one of the better ones of the day. It's Sauerbrunn now.
Good to see Megan Klingenberg back too after that. Almost September was her last time she played with the national team, 2016, and she said, as I just mentioned, that back has been bothering her since May of 2016.
Big part of that U.S. 2015 FIFA Women's World Cup winning squad in Canada. Casey Short trying to dribble her way out of that one. Here's Klingenberg, cushions it down nicely now as she picks her head up. Played 19 times for the Houston Dash in this stadium. Now with the Portland Thorns. Mewis. It's a good ball by Mewis. It's turned the Russian defense. It's Mallory Pugh. Dunn hitting the penalty area. Lloyd as well. And the final ball not there. Mewis will try it. Shot is blocked. And it goes back to Grichenko now, who will just clear the lines for Russia.
And that's the last piece of the puzzle here for the United States, is that final ball in. You're seeing them turn the corner. They're getting in line. But too many times, just not quite finding the player. And you're also seeing Carly Lloyd coming back a lot because the space is in midfield. She's going to have to resist that temptation to come back and get that ball and stay higher for the United States.
There's the captain, Lloyd, stepping in as Russian center back Makarenko. He's got 47 caps, one of the more experienced players out here. A lot of the players were a nucleus. Sauerbrunn. How dependable is Becky Sauerbrunn? So calming, so steady. Won the NWSL twice with FC Kansas City. Lloyd was spinning off there. Dunn couldn't pick her out as she dropped deeper into midfield. And here's O'Hara. U.S. essentially just leaving two center backs back with Mewis in front of them against Russia here and pushing very high. They're two wide outside backs. MLS Live is back with an all-new platform for 2017. Get the most matches ever. It starts at $14.99 a month. Watch Major League Soccer on your phone, computer, or TV. Also available through Roku and Apple TV. Subscribe today at live.mlssoccer.com. So 29 minutes in, Julie, your general thoughts.
it slowed down a little bit, of course, and a lot of that is the heat of Houston. It's a good 80-plus degrees here and some humidity, so you can see it's taking its toll.
It's a cold front down here. What are you talking about?
This is freezing for April. But there needs to be more pace, and there needs to be little tighter angles, given that Russia is literally dropping into about 20 yards of space, finding those little seams, tighter passes, a little bit more movement. One of the things Jill Ellis talked a lot about is that mobility in front of the ball.
Here's Lavelle again orchestrating the attack. It's tackled away here. It'll be a corner for the United States. O'Hara was getting forward, tackled away there by Ziatstanova. 30th minute, U.S. with a 1-0 lead. Not the sharpest via that final ball, maybe. Chenko has come up with a number of stellar saves here in goal for Russia to keep the score line at 1-0. It's Lavelle off the corner towards the near post. Dunn was crashing there. And it's not towards Karpova, who essentially is just getting blanketed and shadowed by Casey Short. Allie Long now. Lavelle just flicks a little header towards the end line. Even the pace of Crystal Dunn is not going to get to that one, but almost did. Good look at Jill Ellis has said, look, there is a big commitment now to movement and mobility and getting players in front of the ball. And we heard that in the press conference yesterday repeatedly.
When they're so tight as they are, Russia playing as they are, it's easy to fall into getting a little bit static because you feel like there's not a lot of space. It's when you just got to pop into a different angle. Small little seams. I mean, look at that 20 yards of 10 players. And especially that quick switch. Russia also condensing almost to the mid line.
Is the ball moving off the feet of the U.S. players quick enough here at this stage?
It's too slow right now, for sure.
Mallory Pugh now has gotten in behind here. Frost will come in the box, skips into the grateful arms of Grichenko.
With the pace to get in behind Russia all day. Now the missing piece, as we talked about, is that final ball in. And Dunn trying to get to that near post.
Long, O'Hara now. A little bit of one-touch soccer being played here. Here's Crystal Dunn. She's turning. She's trying to hit the feet of Lloyd. He tried to sweep it in front of herself, but was marked nicely there by Makarenko. Dominant ball possession here from the United States. Still, it's one goal from the penalty spot here in the 20th minute by Carly Lloyd. That's the difference in the 33rd minute. This is Mewis who's decided to join in here. Pugh was knifing in there. And it's Mewis who comes back to win the ball and earn a free kick. Talk a little bit about Sam Mewis, Julie, because Jill Ellis is very, very high on her.
Yeah, and you said it earlier, investing a lot of minutes and did very well with the New York Flash this year, Western New York team, obviously winning the championship with the NWSL. And that was a young team, and she's really been a leader with that younger group. You saw her in the CBA negotiations talking about it and how thrilled she was to even be included in that group.
Lavelle will get it into the box. It's a big swing and a punch and a little bit of pinball wizardry here. The offside flag was up. It'll be a free kick for Russia. And by the way, at halftime, don't miss Julie with six of the U.S. players talking about the collective bargaining success that has occurred here. It's exciting times, optimistic times now for the U.S. women.
And the other thing about Mewis too is she brings an engine. You just saw it there, right? She's getting forward and then she's the first one back recovering there.
Also a great threat off set pieces as well. Good aerial game. Lavelle showing up inside, quick ball to her partner Mallory Pugh. Here's Pugh, beats one, still Pugh, self pass. Dazzling quick feet of Mallory Pugh. Lavelle tries to sweep her first touch into a shooting position, and it's clear, but these two youngsters really providing some excitement here.
And you see they have the individual class to break down teams, to get around them. I think that was something that we just couldn't find when you go back to the Olympics against Sweden. What player was going to break down that compact system?
Crystal Dunn kind of got mugged outside the box here, got dragged down. It'll be a free kick now. Again, it was Makarenko who's been in and around it here, to her credit, for Russia. Russia's been looking to play the best competition they possibly can since November. They've played Belgium, Brazil, Italy. They've had a team camp in Spain. They've played Finland and Holland. Went to the Algarve Cup. Trying to get themselves prepared for the 2017 Women's European Championships in the Netherlands. It's Lavelle towards the six. O'Hara flips it in, and off the line is Grachenko, with Mewis and Lloyd in there trying to get the slightest of touches.
Grachenko's been solid. Doesn't come fishing for that one positionally, then off her line to grab this one. She's been good for Russia. She didn't play in that Thursday night game. Solid holding balls. She kept her line against Kelly O'Hara earlier in this half when she launched one at her.
Yeah, she's been real aggressive off her line. Took a real shot to the head from Carly Lloyd in the very beginning of this game. But, she single-handedly, to a degree, is keeping Russia in this. Klingenberg. Of course, Casey Short, who's playing as a center back, could play as a left back as well. It's interesting to see the competition in the outside back positions for the U.S. Nice ball over the top. Rose Lavelle is in to make it two for the U.S. Rose Lavelle has. It is 2-0 United States. The 21-year-old has scored her first goal for the United States. Rose Lavelle is one for the future.
Here's the money play for the United States, is you got to get in that seam, which Mallory Pugh does, and then gets her head up. Again, an over-aggressive Russia line leaves so much space. And Rose Lavelle has talked about one of the things she wants to improve on with her game is finishing. And there she is, calm and collected, finding that gap on the near post. Grachenko gets caught diving to the left. What a nice finish and ball in from Mallory Pugh to find Rose Lavelle.
Lavelle will turn 22 on May 14th. And to your point, Julie, you heard the same interview I did after the game. They asked her on Thursday, what is it you want to do? And basically said, score goals.
And that's the danger of Lavelle. That's a right midfielder, given the freedom to float inside.
Oh, Lloyd is laid on a good ball. Klingenberg is in here. Dunn is in the middle of the box. Crystal Dunn. She'll slide volley it in. The great delivery from Klingenberg. It's 3-0 the United States now in the 38th minute. Dunn has picked up her third goal in two games against Russia.
And again, a seam to wide. Klingenberg, that's the left back in forward. A nice ball in by Dunn. Russia just showing its fatigue. Can't even get back. Dunn on that other side. Kling taking a look. And there it is. That's an easy finish for Crystal Dunn. Russia just can't get back. Look at Dunn just making it, getting there first.
So Crystal Dunn now. It's her 21st goal for the United States today, coming in her 50th appearance, a symbolic appearance number for a national team player here. Lewis. Wonderful little touch there from O'Hara to get out of that trouble. But the U.S. exerting control now here on the score line as well against Russia. Got about 80% of the possession here as Carly Lloyd stands on. Kelly O'Hara, I know you always love to talk about her being a forward at Stanford.
I didn't even say the fine institution she went to today.
I figured I'd do it, beat you to the punch here. But it's interesting because we've seen her really playing today as a midfielder and as an attacking player.
And she loves that. And that's really her strength, is she gives you so many offensive options from that right back position. You can't even see her in the picture because she's so high on the sideline there as essentially what has turned into a forward much of today.
Oh, look at Lavelle, with like she's got eyes in the back of her head. The Mallory Pugh, her shot is easily handled. She had Carly Lloyd hitting the six in the end. That probably deserved a better ending.
And Russia condensing all the way to the halfway line, coming across the field, leaves that flank entirely open. U.S. doing a good job of finding it again, but Pugh can do better on that one for sure. Had more time than she thought.
Russia will knock it forward. Stabbing at it there was Sauerbrunn. Russia will get the throw in here. Base of their squad, number of them missing, made up their 2005 UEFA Under-19 champions. Three goals in two games, so Russia's a fun team for Crystal Dunn to play against. She played in the NWSL final for the Washington Spirit right here at BBVA Compass Stadium last season. Spirit seemingly had the title won, and Western New York Flash came back to win it in penalties. Goal in stoppage time. Great final. Throw in short, got ahead on it. And it's going to be a penalty for Russia. They're going to call it on Casey Short here. But going to the penalty spot is Karen Abt. And a yellow card is issued here. So Russia will have a chance.
Wow.
Score here against the United States.
Here it is. I didn't see much on that in live play. Gives her a little tug. Not much on Dunn's the other side. So, but not, I don't see enough of. I don't see much on that. She's coming back into Short. For that to be a penalty.
Nadezhda Karpova is one of their key attacking players, standing over this against Ashlyn Harris. Karpova blasts it straight up the middle and high. And Russia gets on the scoreboard, and it's a confidence builder for them.
Definitely will give a little life to Russia, who in these closing minutes of the first half was looking very tired. If in doubt, just blast it down the middle. But that will definitely give a boost to Russia, because those two back-to-back goals for the United States are energy sappers on a day like today.
Three goals in the last 7 minutes between these two teams, but on a day where you've been chasing shadows in the ball, to score a goal like that can be uplifting for the Russians. Lloyd now. Strokes it out wide with her left foot. Klingenberg now. He's got Mallory Pugh kind of diagonal towards the corner flag. Allie Long. Karpova trying to come back here. Here's Casey Short. Late tackle there from Karpova. She's going to pick up a yellow as absolutely decks Becky Sauerbrunn.
Lone woman up top, Karpova. Clumsy and late.
Six teams currently in the Russian Pro League, eight next year. And coming up at halftime, again, U.S. players on CBA negotiations. And Rose Lavelle scoring her first international goal here today at BBVA Compass Stadium, came in fine fashion. So a lot of great stuff here at halftime. Stay with us. Mewis just overhit it, and Lavelle still almost gets there. He's adopted a central position. I guess we were calling them wingers before the game, but they've been all over the place.
And it's great to see that she has the freedom to do that, because naturally she drifts inside because that's what she played in college. That's where she's played on the youth national team.
You do have to be careful. This isn't the true litmus test, because you do see the gap between the number 25 team in the world and the number 2 team in the world. And in the context of the big picture, Julie, the rest of the world is catching up to U.S.
Absolutely.
Soccer.
Absolutely. And you saw it in March. Clearly. Last time U.S. lost on home soil back to back without scoring a goal. They never lost two like that without scoring a goal. It'd been 16 years before they lost two back to back.
I remember when you and I were talking about France from 4 or 5 years ago, and we saw all that amazing technical ability that comes from a French soccer culture. And we were saying one day, when they marry that with the athleticism, watch out. And I think that time has come, and has come in probably the recent year and a half.
And now you have coupled with it, mentally, they know they can beat the United States. And I think that's always been the biggest hurdle for teams like France, is they couldn't ever finish the U.S. off. They'd get up and then they'd lose the game, or the U.S. would come back. So I think that's a huge hurdle for them, confidence wise as well, to beat them at home as they did. So convincingly.
Yeah, that's considered one of the greatest wins, if not the greatest win, in the history of French women's football. That's a great point. Crystal Dunn, Carly Lloyd now.
I think in the second half you're going to see some fresh legs come on for the U.S. and players that wanting to make their mark on this U.S. team to show Jill Ellis there's not many looks they're going to get. They got two games in June, but with the league starting, that they need to be coming back consistently onto this roster.
It's Casey Shore. And she's burst onto the scene here in recent times. Depth of the player pool getting bigger, more competitive. That's not a bad ball. And alert, because Ashlyn Harris comes off her line here to cut that cross out. Alert goalkeeping. For Russia today, it's all about mitigating the U.S. attack, and it's been tough. They've done a tremendous amount of defending and running. Here's Carly Lloyd to the end line. Try to steer it back. It's mishandled by Grachenko. Crystal Dunn was trying to stuff it in at the back post. It'll be a corner for the U.S. here. And maybe one of the last plays of the first half. Huge block there from Makarenko of Russia.
To get back. And really, Dunn was the only one in the box for Lloyd, getting on the end of that one.
Lavelle laces it in. Ball's headed down. It's an own goal. Believe it came off of Kovalenko. It is now 4-1 United States.
And that's a killer just mentally for Russia. Just tries to stick a foot out. Lloyd getting that on the end of that. But what a killer, because you just got the penalty kick. You get a little momentum. Hopefully you're thinking as Russia going into that half. And now you've got a big hole to climb out of.
Karen App blows the whistle. First half comes to an end. The United States getting a late fourth goal off the own goal. A 4-1 lead over Russia. Julie, thoughts in the first half?
I thought started good, got a little bit slow, and then of course it picked up at the end there. But I think the thing they're going to focus on is movement in this heat, is still keeping the ball moving, getting into those seams, and then getting that quick switch on. So much success if they can find the seams and get that quick switch on.
Stay with us on ESPN. Julie, we'll sit down with several U.S. Women's National Team players and discuss the recent collective bargaining agreement.
For that next set of players and the next set of players. And so we always had to go back to that. It's like, what will make this program the best it can be 20 years down the road, 50 years down the road?
If you get up early to get more done, if you believe hard work makes you stronger, don't settle for anything less than the hardest working, smoothest riding side-by-side ever built. Polaris Rangers help you haul more, pull more, dump more, and make more of your free time when the work is done. Polaris Ranger, like you, we're driven to do more. And now's the time to get up to $1,200 cash back during the Polaris Spring Sales Event.
Welcome back to Houston, Texas, and BBVA Compass Stadium. The United States women's national team and Russia continue to battle it out. My partner Julie Foudy yesterday sat down with six U.S. national team players to talk about the collective bargaining agreement.
First off, congrats.
Thank you. Woo!
How did you celebrate the moment?
It was just like one of those moments where we're like,
is this real?
Oh, yeah.
We're like, yeah.
You know, we did one of those like jumping hugs.
Aww. It was a big love fest.
Yeah. It was good.
I know there was a real effort to think beyond just this current group, of course. How did that come about?
We came together and had so many workshops about, like, what's the vision for not only this PA, but for women's soccer in general. And so we knew that going into this, we weren't just looking out for the best interests of the players in the room, but for that next set of players and the next set of players. And so we always had to go back to that. It's like, what will make this program the best it can be 20 years down the road, 50 years down the road?
What people may not understand is how involved you all were in the process. Mm-hmm.
Everyone played their part. People had different ideas and opinions of what they prioritized in the upcoming CBA and what they wanted to push. So it was a huge team effort.
Favorite story from all the negotiations from the last year?
I think the dynamic between the players and the Federation has been such that they sort of dictate what the terms of the contract are going to be. So I felt this time there were so many times where we were just like, nope, that's not happening. Like, that is not what we want. That's not what we deserve. We're standing strong in this. We're standing firm as a team, and sort of being able to go back as a group and being like, yes, we are unified on this, and being like, no, we deserve better. Those little moments kind of stand out to me.
What'd you learn about each other?
That really brilliant women on this team.
Mm-hmm.
Brilliant women.
Yeah. And obviously everyone knows. People, if you're a part of this team, you're dedicated, but it's not just to the on-field performance, it's to everything. The dedication was pretty incredible to see.
USA Hockey, of course, stood up to its federation.
And then they won.
Is this a start to a movement, you think?
I think we're in the middle of the movement, really. I think that we can look back at things in our past and kind of know that we've piggybacked off that or gained momentum from that. I think that just in general, women are sick and tired of coming second all the time and being sort of pushed aside.
What is a message you would tell a female athlete in whatever corner of the world who may be fighting for just a right to play?
I would say that if you're not happy with status quo, you need to come together, you need to be united, and you just need to keep fighting. One voice is strong, and if you're united, the message will carry.
All about some ESPNW stories? U.S. Soccer ratifying the new collective bargaining agreement with the players. The WNBA draft week, and then, well, this doesn't happen much in college sports, a rare two-sport phenomenon, Kenzie Kent. Stay with us here. When we come back, Julie Foudy and I will break down the first half highlights from Houston.
If you get up early to get more done, if you believe hard work makes you stronger, don't settle for anything less than the hardest working, smoothest riding side-by-side ever built. Polaris Rangers help you haul more, pull more, dump more, and make more of your free time when the work is done. Polaris Ranger, like you, we're driven to do more. And now's the time to get up to $1,200 cash back during the Polaris Spring Sales Event.
What makes a Wendy's hamburger different? Fresh beef. And while Wendy's may have to go the extra mile to never use frozen beef, unlike some other guys, the result is so worth it. Wendy's, the official hamburger of the NCAA.
Welcome back to a very warm Houston, Texas here at halftime. It is a 4-1 lead as you look at the downtown skyline here, the U.S. over Russia here. And it seems, Glenn Davis alongside Julie Foudy, that the U.S. have just carried on from Frisco, Texas 4 days ago.
Yeah, and it at the beginning of that half, it was a compact Russian defense. You can see the fatigue, though. As that half wore on, the gaps are opening up. U.S. taking advantage of that clearly in the first half.
Let's take a look at first half highlights here. And they get their first goal off sheer effort here.
Yes, a little bit sloppy, but Casey Short making the effort, Dunn getting in. And then, of course, you would bet from the spot on Carly Lloyd to finish that. And that kind of broke open the game a little bit for the United States. And then look at this ball in from Mallory Pugh into Rose Lavelle, the 18-year-old to the 21-year-old who just calmly puts it near post. And there is Rose Lavelle showing what she can do with a U.S. jersey on. And again, Carly Lloyd in that space, Klingenberg getting wide, finding Dunn for the easy goal. But Rose Lavelle, by the way, the first University of Wisconsin alum to score, Glenn Davis.
And her first ever goal for the national team. We'll come back to Houston. More to come on ESPN. U.S. 4, Russia 1.
Whether you work hard or play harder, now is the time to buy a new Polaris. Every ATV and side-by-side in the world's best-selling lineup is priced to move during the Polaris Spring Sales Event. Get started at Polaris.com.
Don't miss the MLS action on ESPN and Fox.
Yesterday in Houston, the annual art car parade taking place here. There's the mayor, Sylvester Turner. And some of these cars are unbelievable. But a little lowrider action down here in Houston, Julie. They got that one out of my garage. Now that's mine right there.
Nice.
The bumblebee.
That's classic.
Just thousands of people lining the streets of Houston.
Oh, I was going to say, where's my favorite?
And that one's homage to all the bass fishermen in Texas.
Nice. That's yours.
Lots of fun in downtown, and it's lots of fun here at BBVA Compass Stadium. Russia in red, the United States in white. Second half about to get underway. Rose Lavelle scoring her first ever goal for the United States. A memorable day for her already. And it's game on here. Your referee is Karen Apt. The second half, if you're in the United States, what are you looking for, Julie?
I think more pace, more mobility. It's easy to get lulled in with the heat and with the compact style of Russia to say, okay, let's keep the ball moving. One of the things Jill Ellis talked a lot about yesterday was that mobility in front of the ball. Off the ball.
It's one of the challenges here not to play down to Russia, and that's not being disrespectful to Russia, but there is a gap and a void between the number 25 team in the world and the number 2 team in the world as we look at first half stats.
Absolutely, and when you sit with that much possession as well, it's easy to go backwards because that's where the space is.
Casey Short already in the second half here. Mallory Pugh pushing high. Klingenberg knocks it inside. Here's Allie Long. Short's ball is going to get cut out. Russia has made 3 changes here in the second half. Katerina Morozova has come on.
left back position. Of course, Diva has come on, number 16, as well as Lazareva, number 5. The Rush has made 3 changes. And we would expect a number of changes at some point from the United States, but Jill Ellis keeping the same complement out here to start the second half, Julie. Offside flag is up on the goal scorer, Karpova. 5th goal for Karpova in only her 11th appearance, scoring from the penalty spot. As Klingenberg switches it now to Sauerbrunn. And Sauerbrunn just such an outstanding leader at the back for the United States. Here's Carly Lloyd. Long now. Mallory Pugh is going to get there first. Dunn is getting into the box. Crystal Dunn has scored. Sweeps it in with her left foot. It is now 5-1. The United States. Dunn will pick up a second here today. Mallory Pugh, the architect.
Nice little ball in to get in behind, and Pugh with the pace to get in behind. And that was the thing missing a little bit in that first half, is that final ball. Pugh looking up, sliding it in, and she's going to get in all day on Russia in this second half. And where those runners are flying in.
Crystal Dunna has a pair of goals here today. She's got 10 goals in 9 overall matches in Texas, so she loves to play here in the Lone Star State. As Ashlyn Harris does well to get off her line, distributing now to O'Hara.
Karpova, though, for Russia, still has got an engine up there. She's been playing that lone striker this game.
A little bit of an edge, too. She's been pretty much on an island, just fruitlessly chasing balls knocked up forward to her against an amazing athlete in Casey Short, like right here. Short is going to win the header nicely to Mallory Pugh. Debate rages on. Who's going to ultimately become the number one for the United States in goal?
Jill mentioned to Ellis yesterday that she definitely is going to be giving multiple keepers, goalkeepers caps, not just starting to narrow down into one.
And again, the U.S. focusing on the 2019 Women's World Cup, and then the Olympics come a year later in 2020. So it is the time to experiment. It is the time to assess. Without the pressure of big competitions right around the corner. How much can you really learn today, Julie, from a game like this? 2 games like this.
That's a tough one. I mean,
sorry, I had to ask.
I know. It's hard because you clearly see there's just a talent gap, right? The U.S. is way above Russia, and especially physically as well. You're seeing Russia's going to fade in the second half, and so. But you also come off saying, okay, there's going to be a lot of teams that are going to play this way against us, even in World Cup competitions, Olympic competitions. Teams that aren't as good are going to bunker in like this, and you take it as an opportunity to get better playing a compacted, condensed, bunkered defense. But would they prefer Germany, France, and England again? Absolutely.
Allie Long has won it in a good area. Lloyd to her right now. Long towards Crystal Dunn, who might not have expected that. Probably should have been. Long looked off the run of Carly Lloyd. Here's Sauerbrunn now. Has not scored for the U.S. in all these games that she's played for them. Well over 100 caps, the All-American from the University of Virginia. 11 years ago, Becky Sauerbrunn picked up her first cap against Canada. Boyd will try a little chipped ball that'll go wide.
Our next MLS match on ESPN is Friday at 7 p.m. Eastern. Will be at Talen Energy Stadium in Philadelphia for the Union taking on David Villa and the New York City and New York City FC. MLS Special Edition presented by Audi. It's also streaming live on the ESPN app and watch ESPN. And don't forget, coming up next, Eastern Conference clash between Kyle Larin and Orlando City and Bradley Wright Phillips and the Red Bulls. MLS Soccer Sunday presented by Audi, also streaming live on the ESPN app and watch ESPN. We'll be heading down to Orlando. Call on that Adrian Healy and Taylor Twellman. Of course, there was big news, Julie, that Marta is going to join the Orlando Pride of the NWSL alongside Alex Morgan down there. Lots of things happening in Orlando soccer-wise. MLS and NWSL-wise.
Great fan base down there, too.
New national TV package for the NWSL with Lifetime. New York Flash becomes the North Carolina Courage after winning the title last year, and then Internationals joining NWSL. There's so much going on. Marta to Orlando
huge names.
Henri to Portland.
Yeah, and people know Marta, of course, but Henri is a great addition to Portland. What a wonderful midfielder. And Orlando, of course, having that Brazilian connection with their ownership and CEO.
We'll be able to watch Rose Lavelle with the Boston Breakers trying to bring a revival into that market. And here is Lavelle. She'll run over it. It's knifed in there by Mewis, who, boy, slipped a hard ball along the ground to Lloyd, who was making an angled run. And here we go. Substitution time and a number of huge names coming on here for the United States. Megan Oyster's going to get her second cap, but the familiarity of Alex Morgan and Kristen Press coming on. Carly Lloyd is going to go off. Here in Houston, the huge applause, the two-time FIFA Women's World Cup Women's Player of the Year. Big shouts for Alex Morgan. Megan Oyster will pick up a second cap, and Rose Lavelle will go off. I'm sad Rose Lavelle's going off.
Don't be sad, Glenn. You'll because, see more of her.
Because Kristen Press is coming up. Press, a two-time NWSL first team member. Appearing today for the 84th time. And another one out of Stanford.
Like Casey Short's going to pop out to that left back position with Oyster going centrally. So it's Klingenberg, Sauerbrunn, Oyster, and Short. Press just going a straight swap for Rose Lavelle, right midfield to right midfield. And Alex Morgan coming up front with Dunn.
Dunn's going to earn a free kick. You and I had the pleasure of calling the NCAA Women's College Cup when Megan Oyster and UCLA won it in Cary, North Carolina, a couple years back. Mewis puts it in. The header, parried away. Getting on the end of it was the head ball animal, Allie Long.
That would have been her sixth goal, all from headers, and such a threat in these situations. For this reason, she gets so many on frame, so good in the air. Grichenko there with the save again, keeping Russia in this in the second half.
She's clearly been outstanding today for Russia, Grichenko. So playing short one, here's Megan Klingenberg, who remains in. Drives a left-footed ball in, that took a deflection. It'll be another corner for the U.S. now in the 56th minute with a 5-1 lead over Russia.
Allie Long always, and Mewis, you see both of them on the line in front of the goalkeeper. Clear targets for the United States.
Well, driven in again. It's headed away by Russia now. Press trying to get there. captain of the Chicago Red Stars, and she's another one that's going to be right here in Houston to start the NWSL season next Saturday. Red Stars and Dash and games all over the country as the NWSL will finally get it going. Nakarenko is certainly giving it her all at the back here today. She must feel like she's playing against 13 players. But again, let's not demean what this means to Russia. This is a great opportunity for them to prepare for the European Championships in the Netherlands. It's Pew here. And you can see what she's going to do. She's going to wrap her foot around it. And almost getting ahead on it was Alex Morgan. Beautiful delivery from Mallory Pew.
What a nice ball in that is, because if even if someone doesn't get a touch on it, that might be curling in right there. And all it takes is a little deflection, which is what Morgan is trying to do there.
What do you think goes on in the mind of Alex Morgan seeing Crystal Dunn and Carly Lloyd paired up front? I mean, it's competition time.
And I think it's quite a motivator, of course. She hasn't been getting the minutes that she typically was getting before.
I think that has a lot to do with her move to Lyon.
No, I think. You mean less minutes?
Oh, it's a good ball from Morgan. Trying to pick out Mallory Pugh. No, just to keep playing a little bit earlier, get over there, get more games, a different environment.
Oh, why she went to Lyon?
Yes.
I thought you meant less minutes.
Same reasons as Carly.
I think they wanted a change of environment. I think it was a chance to say and a chance to make a lot of money quickly, but also I think most importantly for them is that it's a chance to train differently.
Long was getting in there. It'll be a goal kick. It was the tackle there coming in from Katarina Morozova, the second half substitute.
Alex Morgan said at Lyon that literally when there's a national team call up, there's no players left to train at Lyon, because not only do they have, of course, practically the entire French national team, but they've got players from all over the world, and really Klingenberg quipped, you know, world's best 11 right there.
That's
a great opportunity, because you're training every day against some of the best players in the world, and I think she saw that as here's an opportunity for me to learn.
Casey Short now, who's in that left back position. Julie pointed that out after playing as a center back in the first half, so that versatility, another piece to her game. Carly Lloyd said she thought she was going to have a bigger impact on the women's game by going overseas, going to Manchester City for a couple of months. She was quoted in an article saying that.
Well, and mind you, they're still growing the game so much for women in England and France and all of the countries really outside the United States that the U.S. players are aware that the popularity here in the United States is not the same as it is in Europe and other countries.
U.S. Klingenberg. Nice splitting pass there from Sauerbrunn to Ali Long now. She'll clip it over the top. Second ball is going to be picked up by Pugh, who's floated in central. Pugh and Lavelle throughout today before Lavelle went off. Sort of inverted, coming inside into great pockets of space, which, to your point of breaking down deep defending teams in the future, could be a real asset for the U.S.
I think the other challenge in a game like this that we used to always talk about when you're up quite a bit is not to get complacent. And to push the pace, even as the game slows down, and the tendency is to want to do that.
Mallory Pugh off the corner now. Zonal marking here from Russia. Klingenberg is going to pick up the second ball here. Let's it go for a throw, and out comes Crystal Dunn, and she hits her feet. Dunn, oh, what a turn from Dunn. And a recovery from Russia, but it's last touched by the Russians. And number five, Nazareva, and it'll lead to a corner for the U.S. here. 5-1 lead here, 61st minute.
press to the end line, crosses blocked, another corner for the U.S. Not to mention here, Tobin Heath is out with the back injury, Lindsey Horan with a hip flexor, Morgan Bryan with the knee, and then Julie Johnson off getting married. So there's another four players you throw into this mix. The competition is going to be heavy here the next couple of years.
Good problem to have.
So they call that a champagne problem. Russia here with one of their better buildups, but not able to help it on was Karpova, who just tried to help that ball on. Here's Allie Long now. Over the top is Morgan, which she's always a threat. Grichenko made the good decision to get off her line, couldn't hold it, and Russia will clear it. Did everything right, but couldn't hold it.
This is also going to be a great opportunity to look at the duo of Morgan and Dunn together. And there's Grichenko, who was positioned well to hold that, but just couldn't.
Press and heavy traffic there. Tremendous skill to come out of that. Long. And it's overhit.
It's interesting talking to Crystal Dunn yesterday about playing higher, because she's played in so many different positions. She said, I've actually been playing in that number nine up high for Chelsea, so it's the first time in like forever that I've had a couple months in the same position. And she said, I don't want to get too comfortable in it because I know it's going to change. But she said it's been nice.
Thursday, she had a little problem with the timing of her run. She seemed to have cleaned that up here today. It's been just causing all kinds of tormenting problems for the back line of Russia today. She's got two goals, Crystal Dunn. Elena Terehova about to come on. And off will come Katarina Pantakina. Press has gotten turned here. And it's broken up there by Bella Mitseva. Well, Jill Ellis has spoken about the fact that as she goes into almost completing her third year as a national team coach, was asked yesterday what she learned, and she really went straight to player management and individual conversations with players, and that part of her job as a manager and a coach being more important now.
I think it's the hardest part of managing for any coach.
It's not a bad looking ball here. Terehova got a hit on it. Lewis would love to get one here. Lewis's shot is blocked off the half volley. Getting in front of it was Makarenko. Switch a play from Klingenberg to Short. Short will clip it to the back post. Press was pulling out. Fourth appearance, 41 goals for the U.S. national team, Kristen Press. For the national team than Kristen?
Do I have how many
do.
Did you just say 40?
He's got
41.
Yeah,
I had to at least have like 400.
Oh, yeah.
I have 45. I'm told by Todd
Kristen is trying to
Todd,
run you
come
down
on. I like the 400 number better. 45. She's four short of me. And it took me like 500 caps, and it took Press how many was she at?
Kristen Press on 85th today.
She's such a great finisher.
Look, when you guys were playing games like this, that there was a
this
gap
is why
in
I
talent.
Retired from the national team. I couldn't handle any more games like this, actually.
Yeah, I mean, it's how like, did you how
God,
did you
I just
keep
want
yourselves
Olympics and World Cups and forget these friendlies?
Yeah, how do you keep yourself interested? And that's not being demeaning to Russia,
no,
but this is the
not.
Fact and the reality.
No, and you know, and it actually gets a little frustrating because you're like, gosh, you want every game to be good, but there's just not that many teams still to this day that close that gap. And you would think, you know, 15 years later, been retired now 12 years, that gap would have closed for a lot more teams. And I think that's the frustration, is there's not enough talent out there globally still. And mind you, they are getting better, and we're seeing the Frances and the Englands and the Germanys and all, and Japan, of course. But to me, still, the growth for women's soccer is too slow. When you talk to their press officer, as we did yesterday for Russia, and I say, how popular is the women's game in Russia? And he says, it's non-existent.
And he said it very quickly. He didn't think about it.
It's like, yeah, there's a few schools that play in Moscow, but it's really hard. They got to train with the boys, and it's, you know, girls just don't play.
Yeah, it's not organized like it is here in the United States. He said there were 2 to 3 bigger soccer schools, one of them in Krasnodar, which is a big soccer city, in Moscow, and then sort of several satellite schools, but... You know, the overall popularity, not even close to here in the United States. Done. Morgan got dumped off the ball. Mewis, thinking about it, plays a good ball out wide. Here's Klingenberg. She can whip it in now. Got a lot of players in the box. Took a slight deflection off Bella Matseva.
And press getting to that near post, wanting that ball in. She was looking for it, just that little deflection. Custom problems.
Scoring summary here today. It took the 20th minute penalty kick that opened it up, and then 3 goals in a span of 7 minutes. Lavelle done, and then Karpova from the penalty spot, then the own goal from Kovalienko, and then in the second half, Crystal Dunn picking up her second only 3 minutes in. Sixty-ninth minute here in Houston, Texas. Morgan to Dunn. Boy, and if you're Alex Morgan, like any striker, you want to come off the bench and score goals. Doesn't matter what game it is. You want to be on the score sheet.
Absolutely. When you know, too, how deep this team is with players up front. Press can play up there. You got Amy Rodriguez sitting on the bench there.
Long got out of there. Mallory Pugh zigging, zagging to the feet of Dunn. She'll get it over. Morgan tried to line the left foot up and spears it on the second attempt, and it's held by Grichenko. Mallory Pugh and Dunn setting up Alex Morgan.
Pugh again having her way on the outside there. Getting a second bite at that apple. Does well to put it on frame. Alex just not enough on it.
Last year, Mallory Pugh debuted against the Republic of Ireland. What a year she had. She had 12 starts in 2016 at Highlands Ranch, Colorado. Plays for Real Colorado, who, by the way, had 2 younger players added to this roster here. So, you know, what's out in the water there in Real Colorado? So, Lauren Donaldson.
Yeah, Jalen Howell and Sophia Smith. 2 young players. 16 and 17 years old brought in this week. They didn't suit up, but one of the 23 in camp. Had they suited up and played, they would have been the first players to be born after the World Cup, 99 World Cup, to play for the U.S. team.
Time flies. That's a beautifully, well, not beautifully weighted pass, but it was weighted in behind Russia, but diagonal run not there, as Grichenko certainly is going to leave here today holding her head high. And again, valuable experience for Russia. U.S. dominating the possession here. It's been all in the Russian half of the field. Pugh. It did go to the World University Games in Korea in 2015, came in second, as most of this team are students as well as playing in the Pro League. switch a play, and this one, Terahova brought it down. It's won back now by the United States. Megan Oyster comes out of there nicely. Gets her first good moment on the ball here. Tough day for defenders, Julie, because there's really not a lot of pressure. It's more about the mental side, isn't it? Pugh trying to pick out press.
Yeah, especially for someone like Ashlyn Harris as well, who's not getting many touches on the ball. Has done well to stay connected when she needs to be, though.
Now, you've been heavily involved with talking that wonderful piece at halftime about the collective bargaining agreement, and it's led to a lot of optimism now. Take us into that a little bit.
Yeah, it started so contentious, too, which was the interesting thing is how that turned around. You know, over a year ago, they've been negotiating this for a year. And for them to turn around, and they said yesterday, which we didn't put in the piece, they said, look, we just realized it wasn't working that way and that we need to live with U.S. soccer and they need to live with us and we're going to be together. And so we needed to change the tone and so made a real conscious effort to make it more collaborative. And once they did that, they started having more success. But at the same time, not, as you heard Megan Rapinoe was saying the piece, not giving in, right? They were going to stand strong and firm, but it was done in a more collaborative way. And I think that's a healthy approach, and it worked. And they're most pleased that it wasn't just about this current group, which is something that's near and dear to us old ladies on the team as well, that you're taking care of that next generation, which was always our mantra of, you know, it's a blank canvas. How do you make sure it's better for that next group coming in?
So interesting. Jane Campbell, who plays here in Houston for the Houston Dash, is going to come on for Ashlyn Harris. So this is her first cap for the United States, and this is a very big moment for her. Plays at Stanford, has been highly touted.
It's great.
Megan Rapinoe will come on as well. Mallory Pugh will go off. Great day for Mallory Pugh. And there is Campbell. And Lynn Williams for the two-goal scorer, Crystal Dunn. Let's take a look back at Crystal Dunn's two goals here today.
Another active game for Crystal Dunn here. She's just getting wide open and in. Beats both Russian backs to that one. A ball in by Kling. And then on this side of things, a Pugh ball in. Dunn made that look easy, getting in that seam.
Nelly Korovkina has come on for Russia. Just getting back to what you said about the CBA, as you see Dunn today, just continuing to impress. How does that directly draw a line in a thread to Russia in their situation? Is that something that can create an uplifting factor in Russia?
Yeah, and I think it does. It inspires other countries to say, okay, look, this is the standard for sure for other countries to look at. And not just clearly in soccer. I think what you saw happen with women's hockey this week, you saw the Irish women's soccer team standing up to their federation this week and getting a deal done. So sadly, it takes players having to say, hey, this isn't good enough and we need more support. I wish it was a more proactive situation with these federations. Don't get me started on that because I'll go for 2 days on it. But I think that's the message. If you stand together and are unified together, you can get and you can impact change. And that's what this women's team has done with this. And really engaged, rolled up their sleeves.
Rapinoe, Morgan, Terahova, cleared by Russia.
They said yesterday they just had no idea how much work it was going to be. They said, we're so pleased that we don't have to do that again for 5 years, but it was so important that they did get involved because they said they learned so much.
You could see the sense of relief on the players and even Jill Ellis, you know, now that this is all behind them and they can focus on the 2019 World Cup and what's in front of them. Here's Lynn Williams. Spent some dramatic moments here. Morgan's denied by Grichenko. The offside flag was up anyway, but still, it's more good goalkeeping from Julia Grichenko here today for Russia, denying Alex Morgan in that one-on-one situation.
And now with Lynn Williams as well, who fed that ball into Alex Morgan. Again, pace up front with those two. Lynn Williams having such a good season last year with her 11 goals, co-led the league with Kalia Ojai, who's also sitting on the bench here for the U.S. team, ended up being the Golden Boot winner for the NWSL.
On the title right here at BBVA Compass Stadium. Well, in Orlando, it is coming up. It's Orlando City taking on the New York Red Bulls. Sasha Kljestan, 34 assists since 2015, had 20 last year. Orlando City and the New York Red Bulls coming up at 4 Eastern time on ESPN. After this game, we'll throw you down to Adrian Healy and Taylor Twellman for the call of that one. Long now. U.S. Trying to ride this one out, get some energy off a couple of subs coming off the bench here in the 77th minute with a 5-1 lead over Russia. Lynn Williams. Makarenko coming out of the middle to break that play up. She did have the game winner against Germany to start off the She Believes Cup, but nobody expected what would happen after that. The U.S. would get shut out twice. Historic win for England. And a historic win for France. Shut out twice on home soil. That's going to always send shockwaves for the U.S. soccer faithful. But in the end, probably very healthy, according to Jill Ellis. Here's Lynn Williams. Oh, what a turn for press, slipped away. Spectacular play in a tight area. Small window to get the shot off, does. And it's an equally good save by Grichenko.
Press so good in these tight spaces. Just needs a little half window there. Creates it herself. Fakes like she's going to play wide. Nice little turn. Grichenko having a game, keeping this somewhat close, if you can call it that.
Boy, what a spectacular view that was from behind the goal, and what a beautiful turn. Off the corner comes in Grichenko. They're going to call, I believe, a foul on the United States here in front of Grichenko. Alex Morgan was right in the mix there. And just to go back to Alex Morgan and Carly Lloyd, they're going to square off in the UEFA Women's Champions League. Manchester City is going to play Lyon. That's going to find out where we're going to watch that.
I know.
Lyon and Morgan knocked out Wolfsburg in the quarterfinals in front of 14,000 fans. He's also teammates with Canada's Kadisha Buchanan on Lyon. Interesting. Bayern Munich Barcelona is the other semifinal, so it's interesting to see these world-renowned clubs now getting invested
through,
in the women's game. Sauerbrunn. Mewis, Lynn Williams. Long to Rapino. Rapino took up a nice area here. Rapino's shot is pulled wide. Got power on it. Accuracy didn't follow, but Megan Rapino trying to work her way back into it now, who has done so much for the U.S. women's national team over the years.
Good to see her back in as well. Still fighting to come back from that knee injury surgery that happened before the Olympics. Jill Ellis has said just needs a few more games. She'll get those with the professional league starting next week. She said it feels great though.
Well, those can be lonely times, as you know, when you're injured. It's hard to feel a part of the full complement of the group. Pino off the throw. Press came to her. Also get call for the foul on Gustavia. Gustavia appearing today for the 21st time for Russia. Tarahova now has got some room to run with it. One of the more skilled Russian players coming on here in the second half. To play a little bit of space over here into the box. It comes Russia and Tarahova trying to seal off that back post and get on the end of it. Couldn't, but that's probably one of the better Russian attacks here today.
Becky Sauerbrunn just unable to clear it there. This is a nice little ball in. Giving an early test for, trying to give an early test for Jane Campbell, who just came in off the bench. As you mentioned, Glenn playing here in Houston with the Dash, drafted by them. And her first cap for the U.S., which is great to see.
We also saw today Rose Lavelle get her first ever goal for the U.S. women's national team, so a lot of firsts. Mazareva now. Sauerbrunn is going to get there. Jill Ellis mentioning that after these matches, it's on to attending, evaluating, assessing, monitoring all the players with their clubs in the NWSL and overseas. Rapinoe to Williams, who's trying to spin off here. Just too much athleticism, but in the end, can't get the delivery in as Alex Morgan was hitting the 6-yard box. 83rd minute. Next up for the U.S., June 8th at Sweden, June 11th, Norway. A little visit with Pia Sundhage, the former U.S. coach in Sweden. And the U.S. has not beaten Sweden in four attempts.
Amazing,
a loss and three
it?
Draws.
I know. Since Pia has been coach there. That will be a great test.
And again, Russia will start their European Championships July 17th. Hove off the dribble. Here's Allie Long now. We're getting ready to get going for the Portland Thorns. Rapinoe. Coming up, it's Orlando City SC taking on the New York Red Bulls down in Orlando, Florida. And one of the top strikers in all of Major League Soccer making a real name for himself, Kyle Larin, who's got three on the year here. MLS Soccer Sunday on ESPN, presented by Audi. And you will want to stay right here to see that one. New York Red Bulls, a little bit of soul searching after really getting pulled apart right here at BBVA Compass Stadium in Houston by the Houston Dynamo, who incidentally were knocked off by the New England Revolution yesterday. Rapinoe trying to get there, and off her line is Grichenko. Be a part of the Orlando Pride. I know you're excited about that.
Yeah, I think that's great. That fan base down there too is amazing. I love seeing those games and that energy.
Klingenberg flicks it to Williams. Williams is fought through it. Then Williams presses in the box. So was Morgan. It'll be a corner, United States here, 86th minute. Williams, Morgan, Press, all would love to hit the score sheet here today. Megan Rapinoe to take the corner of the Seattle Reign. That ACL tear in 2015, coming back from it. Drives it in towards the near post. Rapinoe. Tries it herself with the left foot, pulls it way behind the goal, and it'll be a goal kick.
She thinks, why not?
So many historic games for Megan Rapinoe. Played at the University of Portland. She's played in a Champions League final, as we were talking about that with Alex Morgan for Leon. So those are two that have a French connection.
And I think if you're the United States, you obviously know this isn't the competition of what they had last month in the She Believes Cup. But you also think, okay, we got 9 goals as of right now on the board for these last two games. You got to run through a lot of different players. You got to see that partnership of Dunn and Lloyd up front.
And that one hit over the top, just taking a big swing at that was Holaviega.
You got to see Rose Lavelle, two youngsters, and Mallory Pugh play out wide. I mean, these are all good things that you look at if you're Jill Ellis in that team. You build on going now overseas when they go in June to play over in Europe.
Terahova to take the corner for Russia. U.S. set up a zone lead to defend this. They'll attack it. It's a great header there from a defensive standpoint from Alex Morgan. Terahova. Knocked it inside. The U.S. trying to win it back here. Into the 88th minute. 22,000 seat BBVA Compass Stadium in Houston, Texas. It was opened in 2011. Allie Long. Lynn Williams. Press trying to hold herself onside. Early ball might have been on. Williams goes out wide to Klingenberg.
Press wanted that ball in behind, and there's that space. She was lining up for that one. Williams didn't see it, but that was the clearly more dangerous ball.
Olaviaga stepping in to win that. It'll get knocked forward here. Megan Oyster. Lynn Williams, a minute of stoppage time added here at BBVA Compass Stadium. Tackled away here by Russia and Marek Makarenko. The U.S. is going to see this one out. And it'll be a comprehensive win here today against Russia. Lynn Williams coming on here in the second half, as well as Megan Rapinoe about to take this corner. Rapino. Kuchenko punched it up in the air and then claims it.
And I think the other obvious positive they take away from this is this time together allowed them to finish the deal, the CBA. So that's 5 years you don't have to spend on that, because that's a lot of energy, boy. And not always the most positive energy, as we've seen. That gets frustrating. So to have that done and say, ugh, we can just play and focus on building the game and building our game is huge.
And again, the big opening weekend of the NWSL in its fifth year now will be this Saturday. Well, Julie, let's put a bow on this one and wrap it up today here.
I think that you look at all the different, besides the fact that it's not the competition that they saw, as I said last month, there's plenty of positives in that. You're seeing some of these young players emerge. You're getting some minutes in for Rapinoe, players like that coming off injuries. Klingenberg was another one.
Karpova caught Allie Long, who's battled industriously in midfield here today. And don't forget, coming up next, Orlando City SC is taking on the New York Red Bulls, as we'll switch it to Major League Soccer. And then on Friday, 7 Eastern time on ESPN and watch ESPN, it's the Philadelphia Union and New York City FC and David Villa. Rapino. Morgan. Towards Rapino, broken up again by Russia. It'll be a mission accomplished here in some phases here for the United States. As Julie mentioned, players like Rapino and Klingenberg coming back off injuries. Competition has continued. The youthful energy has been added with Mallory Pugh and Rose Lavelle, who today gets her first ever international goal. for Russia. It will be on to more preparation for the European Championships in July in the Netherlands. Rapinoe stands over this. Expecting a whistle here shortly from Karen Abt. Rapinoe curls it in. Makarenko. And that does it. 5-1 over Russia. The United States, 2 goals today here for Crystal Dunn. It's a comprehensive win for Jill Ellis and company at BBVA Compass Stadium. There's your 2-goal score. Crystal Dunn, it's 5-1, the United States over Russia. They have beaten them twice in 4 days. It is time now to go to Major League Soccer. Orlando City SC against the New York Red Bulls. Here's Adrian Healy and Taylor Twellman.
Thanks very much indeed.
Whether you work hard or play harder, now is the time to buy a new Polaris. Every ATV and side-by-side in the world's best-selling lineup is priced to move during the Polaris Spring Sales Event. Get started at Polaris.com.
ESPN Films presents One and Not Done, Thursday at 9 on ESPN.
He counted on to provide